Hey there, sports fans. Welcome to the debut of KCK Sports, where we will dive deep into the heartbeat and basketball that resonates through the halls and courts of Kansas City, Kansas public schools. I'm Chuck Holmes, and tonight we're kicking off this pregame extravaganza. Welcome to KCK Public Schools Sports Network.
Today, the elements will collide. The Bulldogs. Wildcats, Hawks, and Sabres are fighting for one thing, Kansas City, Kansas pride.
Kansas City, Kansas Public School District was established in 1886. In over its 138-year history, the district has earned a reputation and legacy for outstanding grades and the development of influential members of society, both locally and nationally. Its history has also been written on the basketball courts around the district, etched in blood, sweat, and cheers, and the unstoppable spirit of competition that defines us. As a graduate of Sumner High School's class of Bicentennial class of 1976, I've lived and breathed the vibrant culture of Kansas City, Kansas public schools, from playing football on Fridays, showcasing my musical talents, and graduating as a member of the National Honor Society. My roots run deep in the Sumner Spartans legacy. But tonight isn't just about my journey. We brought together a team of extraordinary individuals who, like me, have emerged from the hallowed halls of our schools and continue to champion the essence of Kansas City, Kansas basketball. First up, Washington High School's class of 2006, Danae Stuckey Jones. A familiar face to the sports community, we've worked together at MSTC Sports, hosting events in the Gardner-Edison School District. Her resume includes starring at Washington High School and Butler County Community College before signing with Iowa State, where she was named to the All-Big 12 defensive team her senior year. She made three NCAA championship appearances and did not miss a game in three seasons. Oh, by the way, she was also named to the Big 12 Commissioner's Honor Roll 3 out of 4 years. Nowadays, she's a wife and a mother with a daughter playing JV in Washington. She also coaches her son's team, ensuring the next generation feels the thrill of the game. So, Danae, welcome to the panel. Next, we have coach and community activist Moses White, known as Coach Mo from Wyandotte High School's class of 1992. True representation of the Bulldogs' enduring legacy, his coaching journey is remarkable, marked by pivotal roles that shaped basketball in Kansas City. As a founder and head coach of the KC Wolves Club and AAU circuit, Coach Moe's influence extends across grassroots basketball. He coached at Arrowhead Middle School and mentored under the esteemed Kansas Hall of Famer Randy Springs. Coach Moe took charge of the Sumner Academy boys varsity team, clinched the league championship, and earned KCK Coach of the Year honors. Off the court, Moses has a podcast devoted to nurturing the future stars of Kansas City, Kansas. Along with his brother, he started a nonprofit during the pandemic that provided over 2,000 boxes of food and over 400 haircuts to families in the Kansas City, Kansas community. So, Coach Mo, welcome, partner.
Welcome.
All right. And rounding out this powerhouse trio is Karen Jameson, Slagle's class of 1975. Well, before the WNBA, there was the WPBL, the Women's Professional Basketball League. That is where Karen started her professional career with the Minnesota Phillies. While at KU, Karen was coached by the legendary Marion Washington and played with Hall of Famer and Jayhawk legend Lynette Woodard. Karen's love for the game has transitioned seamlessly into coaching for over two decades with the KCMO Public Schools. Her commitment and expertise have left an enduring mark on our local basketball community. So, Karen, welcome.
Glad to be here.
Pleasure to have you here as well. These incredible individuals just aren't here for their titles. They're here to provide insight into the heartbeat of Kansas City, Kansas basketball. So let's explore together the stories, the triumphs, and the spirit that unites us on and off the court. So I'm going to start with you, Danae.
Okay.
It's Since you have the most recent playing experience in the Kansas sports scene, how does this experience influence you as a coach and a player?
Well, first and foremost, I want to say that I learned how to fight through adversity. Coming from an inner city community like this and going out to play in a state like Iowa, it was a culture shock for me. For me, I think just going through that experience and learning a lot of life experiences and being able to bring it back to our community and teach our kids starting at a young age, you know, because I teach kindergarten and first grade right now. And being able to start there and go all the way up to the teenage level, I think I can help them to where they don't get the culture shock like I did. Kind of give them a head start at life of knowing what's going on around us and not just in our community.
So you would say the basketball playing here in Kansas City, Kansas, gave you, it was a culture shock going to Iowa, but it also gave you experience into these different areas.
It did, because the world isn't just our community. You know, the whole, you got to think about United States, you got to think about different countries, and everything has a different dynamic and a different demographic everywhere you go. So, but here our kids only see one demographic, but I like to be able to teach them that there are different demographics and there are different cultures of life to be able to be knowledgeable about, and it helps them in life all around to be more well-rounded.
Well, excellent. I'm looking forward to hearing more of your insight as the evening goes on. So I'm going to go to you now, Coach Moses. Okay. I wonder if you might share with us the most important, impactful game or moment you've shared while coaching in KCK Sports.
Well, there's a lot of moments, but the one that stands out for me is I got an opportunity to coach girls basketball while at Arrowhead Middle School. And in 2010, we had an undefeated Lady Apaches team playing against an undefeated Lady Eagles team at Eisenhower. And the community came out and supported. We actually had over 100 people outside still trying to get in the game. Wow. It was pool, no one else can get in. So it just was, the impact was that our young ladies got to see that our community does support them. They do support sports, they do support them, and the fact that they want to see them succeed. I believe it's very important for our young ladies to know they can be who and what they want to be. And I think that was the experience that impacted.
That's excellent. I think that's one of the goals that we have here at the Kansas City, Kansas Sports Show, is to bring that excitement back to sports here in Kansas City, Kansas,
for sure,
to where the girls and the boys are playing in front of packed houses.
Yes.
I remember that as a high schooler, we played in front of packed houses.
Yeah.
Every night.
Yeah.
And it was, every game was a rivalry game. So we're looking to bring that back. So Coach Karen?
Yes.
You've been deeply involved in coaching for over two decades in the KCMO school district. You played for Marion Washington.
Yes.
And you played with Lynette Woodard at KU. How did this shape you personally, and what does this bring to your coaching ability?
Well, what comes to mind when I speak on Marion Washington was her philosophy of the game and her passion for teaching the fundamentals of the game. And she always would say, great players are made during the off season.
Uh-huh.
And so I've learned just by being with Lynette Woodard in the off season, we would work out together. And, you know, she exposed me to her workouts and how she worked on her skills and all. So I was able to share that with my athletes when I coached in the Kansas City, Missouri School District.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
That's nice. That's great experience to bring. I'm sure that you had more clout than a lot of people really understood playing with Lynette Woodard and being coached by Marion Washington. So welcome all three of you to the panel. This is going to be really good tonight. Tonight, we're going to delve into a game-changing move in the Kansas high school basketball. Talk about the introduction of a 35-second shot clock. It's not going to be implemented this year. It's going to go into an experimental basis next year, hopefully being implemented completely in 2026 school year. But from Danae, from your perspective, why is the shot clock a needed addition to the game, and how will it impact the coaches, the players' approach?
Well, first, I'm excited about it. I think the shot clock is a much needed asset to the game of basketball.
Mm-hmm.
You know, obviously high school is kind of like old in the tradition of not having it yet, but the shot clock is much needed because of the fact that you got so many high school game plans based off of running the motion at the top of the key. You know, us as audience, we don't come to watch you throw the ball back and forth across the wing.
Right.
We want to see basketball. And so just to be able to force the teams to go execute a play, go score a shot, and then give the other team an opportunity to score a shot. You know, so we're not looking at games that got like 25 to 13 or 17.
Mm-hmm.
We can get our scores up to 50 and 60 points and see a really good game, because both teams are able to play now.
I think the addition of the shot clock, using your example, will keep the fans involved longer.
Yes, for sure.
Especially in high school, because kids' short attention span, look up and they're going to get a hot dog and they're going this. And if you're the home team, you have more visitor fans
for sure
that are hanging around because they don't know the atmosphere of the school. So that should be excellent to see. I know one of the arguments that we've had or that's been taking place within the state involving the shot clock is the cost. There are a lot of communities, especially in urban communities, that feel that there may be too much of an expense involved when it comes to that. And I even venture to say that some of the Western Kansas schools, the smaller districts, may have issues and stuff too. So Coach Mo, I'm going to ask you about that. You know, urban schools might face unique challenges in adopting the shot clock due to some financial constraints, but how do you anticipate this change anticipating impacting schools that may struggle to find the necessary equipment?
Well, hearing this at first, I was a little concerned, and I do believe that the KCK coaches have some valid opinions. Coach Richardson from Harmon emphasized having shot clocks were a necessity, but he was urging fundraising or alumni donations to prevent losing players to other schools that are better equipped. Then Coach Collins from Sumner Academy echoed some of the same concerns on costs, foreseeing additional expenses for staffing. He does believe a shot clock is needed and believe that it alters the game's dynamics and offers more opportunities for students and teams to win. So I think it's great. But I also got a chance to speak to the Kansas Public School District Athletic Director and Sam Simmons. And he assures that Kansas Public Schools has the necessary funds to allocate toward the purchase and installation of shot clocks into their programs. So he likened it to like acquiring the play clocks for football, just more equipment to get. And they're already in use now, the play clocks for football. So the decision, he stated, will be made at the right time, dispelling any unique financial challenges for KCK schools.
Well, I'm excited to hear that because KCK public school system will be one of the leaders in making this happen. And so I'm excited to hear that they have the funds and that they are ready to move forward with it.
Proactivity.
I agree with you. So Karen, the shot clock introduces a new layer of strategy, however.
Yes, it does.
How do you see teams adapting their gameplay and what strategies might come into play with the added time element?
Well, welcome to the X's and O's. Coaches have to coach. And also welcome to playing defense and conditioning with players running up and down the floor. Whereas you have one team that might stall the ball and you're sitting on one half of the court for a long period of time. So it's going to require them to understand the game of basketball. It's going to be a benefit for most schools, and I shouldn't say just urban schools, but inexperienced players. When they're on the floor, they will have more opportunities to execute the plays on the floor, which when you're the less experience you have, you have a tendency to want to score faster because you don't want to hold on to that ball.
So what you're saying is the coaches have to coach differently and go back to the X's and O's where teams have to run their offense and they have to dig down on defense.
That's right.
Because they know it for 35 seconds, they got to play hard defense or a little shorter time or whatever. So, but we know it's an experiment right now. It will be an experiment next year, not right now. And like I said, going into the 2026 basketball season, hopefully will become a fixture within the state of Kansas. So that wraps up our insight and our insightful dive into the impact of the 35-second clock on Kansas high school basketball. But stay tuned, folks. When we return, our focus shifts to tonight's matchup between Sumner Academy and the Harmon Hawks. Our team will break it down, offering their expert insights and predictions. So don't go anywhere. We're diving straight to the excitement of tonight's game right after this break.
Right now we're just doing like poetries about traveling, and like this is like the first poem that I really, really understand. Poems weren't really my thing in fourth grade. I think they like seem more interesting in like fifth grade.
Later on, he studies cap code for a moment.
My class does different things from the other classes. We meditate today at morning meeting. We were sharing icebergs. If you don't know what icebergs are, icebergs is just basically like you can see the top of an iceberg, right? That's your you acting happy. The bottom is like all your feelings, all your emotions, what you actually feel. Since we were saying that, we always meditate so like we can get off that. So we don't bring it to us and like bring it in our work.
Every day, I'm gonna ask you, what similes and metaphors did you hear in music?
The way I try to get better every day is like just paying attention, because in third grade, I always had trouble paying attention. So like my grades are terrible. In fourth grade, it's like my teacher, Miss Baroni, she never let me give up. So like I started doing better in fourth grade too. And like in fifth grade, I'm getting better every day, like just by just meditating, because meditating helps me too. And like I'm always trying my best. I'm never like sometimes I can be hard on myself, but like being better every day is like I just let stuff go. Like I just let it fly maybe sometimes. And then like sometimes I don't get a good grade, but then I just get better every day by just paying more attention, and then I just get better grades and better grades. I like basically have all A's this year now. At Francis Woolard, we're getting better every day.
Welcome back, everyone. As we return to the MSTC studios for discussion, let's take out this segment with the focus on the Sumner Academy boys basketball team. I'll start with you, Danae. What standout elements define the journey of Sumner Academy's team this season?
Well, the Sumner Academy boys basketball team actually has a pretty young team. It does consist of a few seniors on the team that got some pretty good leadership. However, they're fairly young. They run an isolation offense, which requires the ball to be in the hands of a particular player, and he creates their offense pretty much. So spread the floor, let him do his thing, and let him work the ball around and get it where it needs to go. They have a pretty good execution on defense as well, a lot of hustle. Looks pretty good.
So we kind of run a pro offense a little bit.
It's a pro offense pretty much.
Mm-hmm. Now, that'd be exciting to see tonight. Coach Mo, you get Harmon. With your insights into the Hawks' strategy, what key elements can we expect from them tonight?
I got a chance to visit Hawk Nation practice yesterday, and the theme was play hard and play with pride. So the key elements for Harmon is to continue to play hard every play, complete every play, compete for the game. They have a few juniors that's developed in the past 2 seniors, so to see the team play hard as a team will be positive.
So they're kind of a young team, and we're looking forward to see what kind of energy they bring to the floor tonight.
Yes.
Against this more experienced Spartan team, more experienced Sabre team. But they're going to be going against a team that's leaders, that's senior led.
Well, it says like David and Goliath.
It's something like that. Yeah. Okay. Well, we know how that
is. Old school voice, new school.
There we go. So, Coach Karen, as a coach, considering the competitive dynamics of league games, how do you believe the coaches of these two teams should approach this matchup to ensure their teams perform at their peak?
Well, since this is not their first time playing against each other, so this time it'll be about the X's and O's. The coach with the most experience with the strategies out there on the floor. You know, you have a few trick plays because people have the videos from the previous games. Mm-hmm. And so you have to be able to go out there and prepare your players to play the game. And it's going to require discipline.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's going to be interesting because you mentioned this is not their first or second time playing this year. This is their third time. So these players should know each other.
Yes.
And these coaches should know each other.
Yes.
In regards. So with that being said, let's take a look. Let's shift our focus to the player highlights. Shining a spotlight on the standout talent shaping this season. I'm going to start with Sumner. Which two players from Sumner's Academy should viewers keep an eye on tonight?
Well, first and foremost, we got our kid, number 11, Vincent Vinny Wing. He is a 6'4 post player who also plays the wing. So pretty much he pulls out to where they run like this 4-1. He can shoot and knock down a 3 from 3 to 4 feet back. He can steal the ball. He can drive in. He can complete a fast break, you know, layup. He's just a kid who plays hard all around. He's a good asset to the Sabres. The second quick kid on the Sumner Sabres team is going to be Jaden Gordon, number 13. He is a senior 6'6" guard, and he's the one that they want the ball to be in his hands. He can do a great step through. He can also do a spin off. I mean, he just penetrates into the middle of the court, and he dishes it off where it needs to go, or he fish it himself. If he's playing hard, the rest of the team is playing hard, and everybody feeds off of his energy. So he's definitely a kid that's going to be a standout player that's going to dictate how the Sumner Sabres come out today.
I look at Benny. Benny's got some range on him when it comes to shooting that jump shot. He's also got some quickness, and you see where Jaden is not afraid to go inside.
At all.
And under Coach Collins, that he emphasizes that. That's the kind
he
of,
really
that's
does.
The kind of game he pushes.
He creates plays, you know, even if it's not a part of the play, he's going to create it. Mm-hmm. Like you see one of the highlight moves that he did was a penetration in. He did a shot fake, and then he did a spin off as a step through. It was, mm-hmm. It's a really unique way of playing. I like to think I had a part of that. But that's another story. Do your thing, Jaden.
We'll talk about that some other time, but let's just put it this way. He got schooled in her driveway. But he turned out to be a pretty good ball player.
Yeah. You know, he's tough, and he really does fight hard.
Okay,
and he's strong.
And at 6 foot, he's not afraid to go inside. And I like
he's
that.
He's not. He plays against big players, little players. He really has no fear. Mm-hmm. So it's just nice to see him grow up as a young man and really just pertain to the skill level that he needs to kind of succeed himself in life.
That's awesome. Now, Coach Mo, you get the Harmon Hawks. Which two players stand out as key contributors to watch closely for these guys? I know they don't have much senior leadership on the floor. They do have some seniors on the team, but their leadership money comes from the juniors that are playing.
Well, I'm going to start off with one senior, Ali Chiron. He is the team captain, and he is their heart. He is the most consistent player that plays hard, and he wants to leave everything on the floor. So how he goes is kind of how the team plays. His energy is just there. Then you cannot forget about Jackson Williams, number two. He's the junior. Jackson is coming into himself. He's beginning to find his game. He's understanding his role, and he takes pride in playing defense. So I think he's going to be the nucleus for them to defense. They're going to lean on him, and those are the two players to watch.
That's awesome. That, you know, as a coach, and all three of you can attest to this, watching a player come to his own during the season or watching him progress from year to year to year, how satisfying is that?
Amazing.
Oh, yeah. That's what you as a coach want.
Mm-hmm. It's rewarding to see it. It's definitely rewarding.
That's the difference in being a coach or being a teacher. Mm-hmm. You want your players to learn and then come into their own, know what their strengths are, know what their weaknesses are, and then to see them accomplish that, that's the key for a coach.
You can't teach the heart of a champion either. So what you see a lot of times in these highlights is these boys are really going at it, and they really do play hard.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm expecting to see that tonight. We're going to talk about the keys real quick. Coach Jameson, okay. You get those. I'm going to turn to you for the keys. And what three fundamental aspects for each team, Sumner Academy and Harmon Hawks, should prioritize this league's matchup?
Okay, there's three things that I would prefer to, and that's time of possession of the ball and also rebounding and communication. I can't stress enough about communication, especially with young players. When you learn how to talk about the game, then you understand the game. So that communication plays a major role when you're out there on the floor, which requires discipline.
Yes.
So those are the three keys that coaches should be stressing out there in order to come out with a victory.
So you're mentioning discipline.
Yes.
And discipline is very, it's a hard thing to coach.
Uh-huh.
And it's a harder thing to watch your kids try to obtain that discipline. And with Sumner having a little bit more senior leadership, I would say their discipline level may be a little bit higher, but you had mentioned earlier that the younger kids look up to the senior.
That's right.
To let him do his or her job
uh-huh.
and lead the team. And as long as they do their job, then everything is okay.
Yeah, well,
how important is discipline when it comes to, even in practice, how important is discipline?
I want to stress practice. That's where the discipline starts. Mm-hmm. As a coach, I don't spend my game time talking about discipline. I work on that during practice mm-hmm. time. And so, especially with young players, and then they have seniors there. So when they have those guys you look up to, there's trust.
Yeah.
You have to be able to trust the players around you in order to be able to execute out on the floor. I can't be on the floor trying to play your role, point guard's role, or the shooting guard's role, or the post player role. Unless mm-hmm. we all be confused.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to trust each other.
Everybody got to know their own role.
I think the discipline, like you said, is the key with communication. With young teams, how you communicate and how well you communicate deals will have what successful you are. Mm-hmm. So tonight it's going to really be the discipline of communicating defensively and then being where they're supposed to be communicating offensively. You'll see which team has more discipline.
Now, I know when I was a player, my coaches would always say practice is the hardest part. I mean, practice is hard. Game should be fun. Game mm-hmm. should be easy. As a player, we practice hard, practice really, really hard. Mm-hmm. And then game time came along, it was a fun aspect or anything else. We didn't think it was fun, but when you look back on it, it was actually fun. Mm-hmm. As coaches, how much emphasis do you actually put on practice when it comes to everything from free throw shooting to discipline to floor general, floor
practice.
Leadership?
Practice.
Oh, don't do the Allen Iverson on me.
I'm just joking because practice is the key. This is the thing. People always say, you know, practice makes perfect. Mm-hmm. Well, I believe practice prepares you. Yeah. So, you know, luck goes to the prepared person. So the more you're in practice, the more you prepare, the more you, you know, perform in practice, it becomes second nature. You can perform in the mm-hmm. game.
Okay. That sounds like a plan. Let's get to our predictions real quick. I'm going to start with you, Danae. What's your prediction for tonight's game?
I'm going to go with Sumner. You know, the numbers look really good for Sumner. They've already won twice. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to go with Sumner just because the leadership with Jaden Gordon, I'm really excited to see him play.
Me too. I'm looking forward to seeing Benny shoot the wing too.
Yeah.
And pun intended. Shoot the wing.
Shoot, get
that?
Yes.
I like that. Okay.
I was going to let it go.
Yeah, we
was all trying to go.
Coach Mo, it's on you, partner. What do you have?
Well, you know, I got ties to both sides. So I was coaching Sumner, coaching Harmon. I love what Coach Collins is doing. He's a great coach. Sumner's a great program. Boo Richardson played for me. I love what he's doing. I have ties to Harmon, but I wore my purple tonight. So I'm gonna go with the Hawks.
And speaking of ties, I like that one. That's
well, thank
nice.
You. He likes my coach. Coach, he's been talking about.
Well, that's another story. Coach Karen, what are you gonna go with tonight?
Well, you know, it's difficult to beat the team three times. And so I'm relying on the coaches out there on the floor. It's going to be the X's and O's. And so I know the coach with the most experience is Coach Collins. So, you know, it'd be exciting to see them get out on the floor and have the trick plays and lead their team to victory.
All right. Well, S-U-M-N-E-R.
So now you're singing your alma mater. You're singing your alma mater.
Okay. So Chuck is going for Sumner.
That's where I'm going.
Chuck's
going for Sumner.
We're just singing our alma mater. We're
going to Sumner. But before we head out to the game between Sumner Academy and Harmon, we'll take a quick commercial break. But stay with us. It's Dr. Jarius Jones, Slagle class of 1993, and Coach Larry Fennell, Slagle class of 1986. They will be providing play-by-play and analysis throughout the game. So we'll see you at halftime for a recap of the first two quarters and what to expect during the second half. Stay with us.
Life at Sumner is tough, but teachers help a lot. It's fun. I like it here. An average day, we go by blocks, so every day is kind of different with classes, practicing skills that we have, preparing for IB. There was an incident with me and one of my friends. We used to have this joke where we flip bags. They take all your stuff out of a bag and flip it, like basically inside out. So really inconvenient. He flipped my bag at the end of the hour while I wasn't in the room, and he wasn't giving it back to me, and there was confrontation that happened, and ended up we had to go to the office and explain to Mr. Malone and them. And then he called our parents and out of school suspension, and then had the dismissal hearing.
He got himself into a situation where we were taking a look at his continued enrollment here at Sumner Academy, but he used that as a learning opportunity and really came back to really focus on his education and really make sure that he rebuilds those relationships that he hurt last year.
Sumner is pretty strict on fights, like they basically zero tolerance, but the staff, when they heard our accounts of it, they understood it was a misunderstanding. It wasn't our character.
And it reminded me of that restorative process that we're trying to put in place and how our students really need that chance and that teachable moment to ensure that they can go out and be successful citizens in our global societies. Tommy's a great example of that, taking an incident that could have been a moment in his life that could have perhaps changed his trajectory, learn from that with the support of our staff to ensure that he's continued to excel. And he's a senior this year and he's going to graduate with the class of 2024.
At Sumner Academy, we are getting better every day.
And welcome, basketball enthusiasts, to the heart of the action here at J.C. Harmon High School, where we have the J.C. Harmon Hawks taking on the Sumner Academy of Arts and Science Sabres. We are here for a great thriller. We thank you, those of you who are joining us here on the KCKPS Sports Network, produced by MSTC Sports. I'm Dr. Jarius Jones, and I am joined by Coach Larry. Coach Larry is here. Welcome back, Coach Larry.
Well, Doc, it's good to be back, man. We've been away for a little while, and so happy to be back and hear that ball hit that hardwood.
Well, we are so happy to be here as well. As I said earlier, welcome home. They caught a double dribble, I believe, against the Sabres. So the first turnover of the game. Ladies and gentlemen, we have action that will be going on. This is the first of six games. That ball was thrown out of bounds by the Hawks, so it will go back to the Sabres. We have a run of six competitions that you will continue to hear about that are upcoming as we begin to pilot this great opportunity. We hope that many of you will be enjoying the broadcast that will be brought live. Each of these facilities showcasing the schools in Kansas City, Kansas Public Schools. Nice pass.
Nice pass by bucket. Vincent. Vincent found his man down low. Angelo, that was a nice pass inside the paint. So Coach Al's going to want a lot more of that.
Absolutely. That was a great basket by Angelo Reese. We saw the steal by number three.
And there we go.
Contreras. Basket was missed. Ball deflected out of bounds. That will go back to the Hawks.
Look by Angelo. Vincent just put the ball up a little hard and the glass a little hard. He missed that shot. I'm sure he'll adjust that on the next one.
Since you did not catch that, the starting lineup for the Sumner Academy boys, the visitors, number one, Anthony Mendez, number three, Marco Contreras, number 11, Vincent Wing, number 13, Jaden Gordon, and number 45, Angelo Reese. For the J.C. Harmon Hawks, we have starting Nyland Arrington Cody, as a forward, number five, Ali Chirombo, number 10, Angel Rivera, number 11, Abdi Sadid, wearing number zero, and number two, Jackson Williams, forward. There's a timeout that's been called on the floor. 30-second timeout. I want you to stay with us at halftime. We will have an interview with Dr. Stubblefield, Dr. Anna Stubblefield, superintendent of schools here in the Kansas City, Kansas Public Schools. She will be joining me as we're so delighted to have this opportunity. I want to give a nice shout out to Mr. Sam Simmons, who is the athletic director for the district. He and Mr. Edwin Burke are responsible for this happening. We have a little bit of a clock issue. I think they started the possession before the timeout ended. Coach, I've been I've worked the clock before, so I know how those things can go.
Oh, it happens sometimes. even if you're paying attention, it still happens.
That's right. It still happens. Hey, you set that clock to automatically do it, and sometimes they come out of it sooner. You have to make those adjustments. So, you know, as a teacher, I had an opportunity to serve as working the clock,
right.
Also working as a PA,
uh-huh.
Public address, also opening up the locker room, hosting the referee. So you do a little bit of everything.
That's right.
We're back to action. Early on, the Sabres have a lead, 2-0. Ball was deflected out of bounds by the Sabres. It stays with the Hawks.
Yeah, Doc, it's going to be real interesting to see how Coach Collins and Coach Richardson match up with each other. You know, they've been playing against each other for many years.
Absolutely. Both Kansas City, Kansas, homegrown. As that's right. Turnover and ball brought down the court. That basket is good. And let it count for Mendez.
And that's exactly what Coach wants. He wants you to go attack that basket. And as we can see, Mendez went out and attacked that basket. And shot is good. It's a little slow on the rotation over there. So we'll try to help you guys out and give you some names of these players out here as these young men are working hard to give us a good game today.
That was the first personal foul on number 11, Angel Rivera. First team foul as that ball is turned over, thrown out of bounds by the Hawks.
Yeah, we see Coach Al put just a little bit of token pressure out there just to make Harmon rush a little bit. We'll see how Harmon handles that here as the game goes on.
Early on, we have the Sabres up 4-0, threatening to score again. Three-point attempt, and it is good.
And that's the shot that Vincent has to make. Coach is looking for him to make that shot as he comes off that screen. It was a good pass, good assist.
Score is 7-0. Ball was deflected by the Sabres. Contreras, great defense. There's a substitution for the Hawks as we see Mekhi Whitmore coming in to the game for his first time, replacing Abdi Sidibe. Thought about taking the shot. Three-point attempt. Just off the rim, rattled off the rim. Nice rebound attempt, but number 11 touched the out-of-bounds line.
So yeah, he was just
out-of-bounds by Angel Rivera. Score is 7-0 in favor of the Sabres. We're at just a little bit over the 5.5-minute mark to go in the first quarter of this competition. Got a bit of a trouble. Another three-point attempt. And that and one is another. Good.
There is another. Harmon's going to have to come out and close out on these guards, but these guards will continue to knock this shot down. And, you know, as a shooter, if you see that ball go in early, you think you have the green light the rest of the game.
Basket was good by Menendez. Sabre defense is really, really tough tonight, and it's very difficult for the Hawks to really get some action. Call that travel. Just at the 4:57 mark, we see another replacement as the two that just replaced each other are coming back in. We also have number 24 for the Sabres coming to the game for the first time, Jackson Davis. I think they may have taken too many steps.
There was a few steps right there. The rule book states that you can only take two after you pick the ball up. He took three. That's a violation.
There you go. That's a violation.
That's a violation.
You all get to know Coach Larry. Coach Larry, I know at some point in time we're going to want to hear your Larryisms. Those Larryisms provide some great pearls of price, of input, great wisdom.
They show up spontaneous.
They show up spontaneous to make sure that we are aware. That was a personal foul call on number 5 for J.C. Harmon, Nylon Arrington Cody. So that's his first. The second team foul shooting free throws is Marco Contreras, and he misses the first.
The front end of the running line.
Here's for his second. That one is off the mark. Disrupted the play just enough, but they said possession will remain with the Hawks.
Yeah, it was a good play right there by Dominic Lopez. Is getting a finger, just a little finger. This pressure is giving Harmon a little trouble here today, Doc. It's classic Coach Al defense.
Another deflection by the Sabres. Ball remains with the Hawks. Head coach for the Sabres is Al Collins Jr. Assistants or Al Collins Sr. I think there's a connection there.
There's a connection.
Carlos Page, as we see, a three-point shot attempt put up, a long one put up, but it did not make contact. That was Sidibe.
Good look. Just a little off.
Carlos Page and Julius Foster also round out the assistant coaches. The coaches for the Harmon Hawks, Boo Richardson, a young man that I've known, as we see a turnover by the Sabres, some miscommunication there, getting the ball in bounds.
Yeah, we see a little chess match going on right now. Coach Richardson decided he'll apply a little pressure and see if Coach Al's team can handle that pressure. And as we know right now, they turned it over. So
absolutely.
I have some adjustments to make.
Substitution number 50 came into the game for the Sabres.
And one.
And they're going to count that basket. So that's going to be an opportunity for a three-point play for Angel Rivera.
That was a good pass right there. And Rivera just went straight to the hole, and no one closed off and stopped the ball. I'm sure Coach Al is letting his team know you need to stop that ball and look that man inside that paint.
First personal foul was committed by number 13, Jaden Gordon. A free throw attempt was missed as we see a drive to the hole by number 13, and he makes it.
What's the rule, Doc? The rule is stop the ball.
The pace has kind of picked up a little bit. 12-2 is the score. We're just under 4 minutes.
Good luck.
Nice basket.
Good luck.
Second basket by Rivera.
Now we see the pace picking up as the players start to get a little comfortable being on the floor, Doc.
After next dead ball, we'll have a timeout. Three-point attempt by number 5, and he was fouled. He was fouled, so he will be shooting 3. That foul was committed by Contreras. That will be his first personal foul, but Nyland, Arrington, Cody will shoot 3 when we come back. Stay tuned. After this commercial break, you're watching KCKPS Sports Network. I don't know if you want to mute it. Todd, if you can help Larry get sound or turn up his volume, that would. And we are back. Okay, we're almost. You just told me to let them play. Just joining us, Nyland Arrington Cody is shooting 3 free throws. He has missed the first 2 just before the timeout. He attempted a three-pointer and was fouled in the act of shooting. He made the last of the 3. So the score is 12-5 in favor of the Sabres. The coaches for the Hawks are Boo Richardson and assistant coaches Derek Bowen and Jelena Kelsey. Coach Leary, I got a chance to see Coach Boo Richardson when he was playing guard at Wynot High School, and I was a math teacher there. Good to see that nice three-point
nice
basket
shot
there.
Right there.
Goodbye, Aaron. Good Cody.
I That was an excellent look. It
really was.
Down and got his feet set and let it fly. Coach Lou Richardson was a good shooter himself.
Nice little defensive play. Deflected by Sadiq. Ball will remain with the Sabres. Like the intensity's kind of picked up, right?
It has picked up a little bit. Doc, I think everybody's a little nervous early. You got started. Yeah. Now it's picked up a little sweat falling down the head.
Another three-point attempt, but that was no good. Ball was put back.
That was a good shot. That was a good putback right there by Jackson Davis on that rebound. Vincent was a little long. And Jackson was there to clean up.
Nice basket. He thought about the three-pointer and decided to drive it. Pass it back out. Number five chooses another three. Not quite, but rebounded. Nice rebound.
That was a good rebound. Coach Collins is not going to be happy about that effort on that board. I know Big Al over there is going to let somebody know about that. These guys got to block out when that ball goes up.
It's a good basket by Ali Chirombo. His first basket of the game. 10-14 is the score. Just under 2 minutes to go in the opening period.
Oh, good
block. Nice block there.
Nice block.
Another deflection. And we see a drive, a steal and a drive, but then stolen back.
Oh,
personal foul. He didn't attempt to do that on purpose, but it
was good hustle. Yeah, no intention on that foul. It was just good hustle by two players right there. It was a good outlet pass to the big man. The big man with a good bounce pass, and it was just kind of unfortunate he got caught underneath. So we hope he's all right. That's a hard call.
Jackson Davis will be shooting the two. That's going to be the second personal foul on Nyland Harrington Cody. Jackson's kind of favoring that wrist and stretching it out.
Yeah, he fell a little bit on it, and the hardwood is exactly what it says, hardwood.
Coach, if you and I fell on it, I don't think it'd feel the same.
I would not be getting up anytime soon, that's for sure. Yeah.
First basket is good there by Jackson Davis. Air ball that he had earlier.
Right.
So, wow, 16-13 is the score. They're just eating at that lead, a large deficit that they had before. Basket was in and out by Huddleston.
Yeah, that was a foul right there by Vincent. He just didn't move his feet and can't put both hands on the man. They're going to call that every time.
Personal foul is committed by Vincent Wing. That's going to be his first personal, third team foul. Both teams are sitting with three team fouls. Hawks try to get it in. Successfully do. Ball control. Initially by Jackson Williams.
That's a travel.
But they're going to call a travel.
Yeah, he moved the puppies a little too early.
Yeah,
a little bit
too early.
He was a little anxious. I understand.
Absolutely.
Coach Blue pulls him out to have a little conversation and settle down. He moved the puppies too fast.
We see another substitution made by the Hawks. So just under a minute to go in this opening quarter of our inaugural game here for the KCKPS Sports Network. Competition between the Sabres and the Hawks here at the J.C. Harmon High School Gymnasium. You see a one attempt.
Oh, that would be a charge.
They're going to call an offensive foul.
Yeah, that would be the classic player out of control charge right there. Sadiq was looking for it. Before that pass, that's a good look. Just needs to stop before it crossed that free throw line.
That foul was committed. Foul was committed by number zero, Abdi Sadiq.
Mm-hmm.
Fourth team foul for the Hawks. 30 seconds remaining in this quarter. Will the Sabres wait and try to go for the final shot? Let's see. Up. Oh. Hawks said not quite as they steal it. Oh, a nice little oopsie doopsie. I don't know if that's what I would call it, but it wasn't quite.
Still called, Doc.
It was a good call.
Good attempt by Rivera. Just didn't make that count. It almost looked like it was slow motion.
It did look a little slow motion. I wasn't sure if it was my old eyes or did he actually move in slow motion.
Yeah, well, you did say you were a sophomore in 1984. So.
Well, that is true. I don't want no trouble. That floor is still hard.
That floor is still hard. That is true. 10 seconds to go in this first quarter. The Sabres are driving it. And the basket is just out. That was a solid drive by Gordon. Well, the first of the quarter is over, but want you to stay tuned. We have a court chat. We're going to start off. We have court chat with Coach Boo Richardson and player Ali Tarombo, J.C. Harmon, then Alan Watson, and player Jaden Gordon with Sumner Academy. We'll be back.
This is court chat. You a head coach from Harmon, Boo Richardson, and I'm with
Ali Tarombo.
Hey, man, we play Sumner. What's our outcome?
We lost first two games against Sumner, you know. Third time's a charm. We want the next game bounce back and hopefully pick out a dub.
All right, man, if you prepare for a game, what's your favorite song?
My favorite song? I don't got a favorite song. I like mix and match them depending on the mood I'm in. But, like, I've been listening to a lot of, you know, Future, a lot of new generation type rappers at the moment.
Cool. So what's your game day shoe?
My game, KDs. No, I like KD 15s. No, feel good on my feet, and I like the double sock when I'm wearing it.
All right. For the Harmon fans in the community, what's one thing you would take from our team in your game and you would have them guys come watch us play? What's one thing?
One thing I take from our team is keeping our heads up, you know, no matter the outcome, always keeping our heads up when we're on and off the floor, you know, and try and be your best, no matter the situation you're in.
My God.
And we are back for the start of the second quarter. First quarter was a spirited one. Sumner came out leading 7-0 really quickly. We ended up, Harmon, they had that missed three-point attempt. Mm-hmm. It was almost like that took the lid off as we see another basket there by Jaden Gordon. Scores 18-13.
And Sumner came out hotter than Harmon. Harmon settled down a little bit, and that's where we're at right now at 18-13. Turning into a good game.
Quick little personal foul by number 3, Marco Contreras. That is his second personal, fourth team foul for the Sabres. So both teams now are dealing with 4 fouls. I know they cleared out the fouls up there, but it's 4-4 for the first half. Nice
good
pass.
Both great. Good passes down low.
Great basket by Rivera.
Great basketball drill. You see the ball come from the top down low, and Sumner didn't rotate fast enough. And easy basket down there.
It's what you would call the high percentage shot. Oh, nice drive.
There is the comeback right there.
Basket good by Reese.
You said if you could pass in the paint and score, so can we. Good look right there. Basket by Reese playing through the contact.
Second personal foul committed by number 11, Rivera. That's the 5th team foul. And the free throw is good to complete the traditional 3-point play. 20-15 is the score. Able to get it over. And who was there waiting? None other than Gordon to take it back. I think they're going to call travel. Coach, what's the rule on that?
Too many steps.
That
is a violation. Too many steps. You must put the ball down on the hardwood and allow it to come back up.
I got you.
And then you move.
It's all right. 21-15 is the score. So we see another drive. High percentage ball just rolls out. Put back. Not quite. Another rebound. So three offensive rebounds.
That's
right
three
there.
Chances right there. No one blocked out for the Sabres. I almost said the Spartans. Nobody blocked
another
out
miss.
For the
I'm sure Coach Richardson will look at the tape and see those missed layups. Point blank shots, as we see a three-point attempt missed, not this time for Arrington Cody. Basket is put in, a nice drive there by nice number 24, drive. Davis.
This was coast to coast right there. No one stopped him. There's no one that stepped up and stopped that ball, and he went all the way through. And the ref said a little body bump right there. A little body bump.
Personal foul was committed by number two, I believe, Jackson Williams. Mm-hmm. That's his first personal foul. Sixth team foul. So we'll see here the free throw. Yeah, the free throw's just off. Rebounded by the Hawks, but a double team there, a trap. Able to, Sadiq was able to thread that ball. Get it to right Whitmore. Looks like there's going to be a personal foul against the Sabres. That foul was committed by Andreas Huddleston. Nice shot there.
Inside the paint. Harmon's doing a good job of putting that ball inside the paint. Moving those big men out and just kind of slicing right inside.
Great basket there.
Sure, some are adjusting.
Timeout is called. Message.
I speak five languages. I speak French, Swahili, Kinyarwanda, Kirundi, and Kinyabwisha, plus English, obviously. I remember when I first came to this country, you know, coming to the country with no language. So it's so kind of stressful. But then I am so grateful that our families and students can be able to get access to everything that they need through me. You can.
We're not touching it. And we are all right. We are back. 6 minutes to go in this first half. We're in the second quarter. The Sabres are leading 23-17. Excuse the technical difficulty. Have a little static here.
Got the ball down, coming down. Harmon has the ball coming down the court now. A little inside pass inside. Oh, and it rolls right in there. What a basket by Cody. That was a good look right there, right? Been talking about that, Doc. We've been talking about that paint being wide open on the Sabres. Coach Al's going to have to look at that and close that off. And we got a shot from the corner. It's coming out. And there's Harmon. Oh, looks like Aaron one rolls off a little bit. He recovers a rebound and a foul on the floor. We got a foul. That foul right there was on Angelo Reese. The referee called it on the ground. So he'll be taking the ball out on the baseline. Number three,
Lopez. 45. Personal foul was committed by number 45, Angelo Reese. That is his first personal. That is the sixth foul for the Sabres. So both teams have six. The Hawks down by four. See another drive here. Decided to give it away. Let's see what the call is going to be. And they're going to call travel.
A couple steps right there.
That's unfortunate.
Took some few extra steps and referee caught it right there.
Checking back into the game for the Hawks is Ali Chirombo replacing Jackson Williams. Defense! Sabres are holding on to a four-point lead as we near the halfway mark of this second quarter. As we hear the Hawks band screaming defense, they're here, they're cheering.
They are up. You may not be able to hear them on TV, but we can hear them loud and clear.
Another basket attempt. They're going to call that a personal foul.
Yeah, that was a little skin contact right there, Doc. That was a little skin contact. We could hear that over here through the headphones. Good call by the referee, Alex.
Personal foul was committed by Sadiq. That is his second personal foul. It's now the seventh team foul of the half, third team foul of the quarter. First free throw was no good. Once again, we invite you to stay with us at halftime. Our illustrious superintendent, Dr. Anna Stubblefield, will be joining us to talk about the launch of the district's new KCKPS Sports Network. She's going to share some insights on the upcoming bond election, so we want you to stay tuned as another travel is committed, another turnover by the Hawks.
That was Ali, just kind of got a little rushed, a little sped up right there.
And there's a full timeout called on the floor. We'll be back after this brief message. You're watching KCKPS Sports Network.
I speak five languages. I speak French, Swahili, Kinyarwanda, Kirundi, and Kinyabwisha, plus English, obviously. I remember when I first came to this country, you know, coming to the country with no language. So it's so kind of stressful. But then I am so grateful that our families and students can be able to get access to everything that they need through me. You can think of all those documents that school sent home, you know, from like the permission slips, you know, inviting them for any event that is happening at school. All the school can send all the documents to me and I can put them in the native languages that the family speaks. I do interpretations as well as translations. So let's say any school needs, they have a meeting that they need family going to be coming to school. So they got to contact us. Then we can go to that school and help that family to make sure that they're getting everything. Besides that, we also connect our families to the resources that they might need. Let's say during winter, they need some warm coats, all those kind of stuff. So we connect to different outside agencies. Everybody got Google Translate, but what we realized, like Google Translate, that it's not 100% accurate. And when it comes to the school stuff, it's very important that our families get things that are very accurate. To me, being better every day, meaning is like, I'm never going to be satisfied until I've done something, you know, for my very best by using my strength, you know, by helping our families. Some of our families through us are trying to be self-satisfied by doing some of the stuff on their own through us, because what we've been doing as well is like showing them how to do things like getting the records online, showing them how to use Infinite Campus in our language. At Multilingual Education Services, we are getting better every day.
And welcome back. We're just at 3 minutes and 55 seconds to go in this first half, second quarter. The Sabres are leading 23-19 against the Hawks. Sabres have possession. So, Coach, what type of What are you seeing out there on the floor?
Right now, we're seeing both teams try to settle into who their what their identity is. And Coach Al just went to move the ball around and see if he can get that zone to move a little bit. So you know, when the game first started, the guys were a little slow at reacting to things, and they got a little sweat built up on the foreheads and loosened up a little bit. And it's been a pretty good game since then. It's been a pretty clean basketball game.
Really I would agree. That was the first personal foul committed by Makai Moore, Whitmore. Shooting two free throws is Jackson Davis. He missed the first of the two. The second free throw was good. That was the eighth team foul. We see a trap put on by the Sabres. It was pretty much effective, but yeah, the ball was last touched by the Sabres.
They're using that to slow Harmon down a little bit, and Harmon's not doing a good job. The guys can't leave the ball handling. When the guy gets the ball, somebody's got to come to him.
Nice possession there. Good ball handling. The three-point basket was just a little bit too long by Arrington Cody. Ball last touched by the Hawks will remain with the Sabres.
Yeah, we're seeing the guys kind of settle into this game now. Dawkins.
Reporting back into the game for the Sabres is Contreras, and for the Hawks is Jackson Williams. Definitely the zone is in effect. Summers in no rush. Three-point attempt looked like it was deflected. And they're going to call that a personal foul. I thought that I saw someone's grab. Coach,
that was a foul. We see Coach Richmond jump up. He just wanted to hold his hands up and not reach down. You know, if you swipe down, the referees are going to call you every time, even if you don't touch him, Doc. They're going to call the foul.
That was the first personal foul committed by Muhammad Charambo. The ninth team foul of the half. The first free throw was good by Gordon. He still has two more as that foul was committed in the act of shooting of a three-point field goal. Second free throw was good. I think the gentlemen are so used to two free throw variety that they're ready to check in as we see checking in for the Harmon Hawks, Whitmore. Yeah.
When there's three, you got to wait for the second one.
Missed the last of the three, but rebounded by the Sabres. Almost lost that. Was Contreras. Ball passed around. Gordon driving again, unable to connect. Hawks were able to rebound. Saw some nice ball play, but a little bit too fancy,
yeah,
Coach.
Well, no one yet wolf for him. So he was out there on the island. Oh, good hustle.
Great hustle there by Whitmore. Able to get it up court. Whitmore with the ball. Three-point basket. Is it good? No good. Just off the mark, but rebounded and put back. Not quite.
That was a good rebound by Angel. Oh, and there's a nickel and dimer. That's the one thing that Coach Richardson does not want. You do not need to foul at the half-court line.
That personal foul was committed by Ali Charambo. That's his first personal foul.
You know, Doc, we see both of these coaches working their team, and they're working their team in a good way. They're just pulling a young man over to the side and saying, hey, settle down. Let's not try to do too much.
There's several attempts. Rivera has had a couple of attempts where point blank and just a little bit too hard, Coach.
Just a little bit.
On the shot. A little bit. We haven't seen Vincent in the game for a while. He's just coming back in. Both free throws are missed. Just a little bit over 2 minutes to go in this half. There's a timeout, a full timeout that's called on the floor. We're going to take a brief timeout. We'll be back after this commercial break. You're watching the KCKPS Sports Network.
To announce that you are the elementary representative for the Horizon Award winner. So congratulations.
I wanted to nominate Hannah Brakewell because she exudes an exemplary teacher. Students in our building truly enjoy coming to music every day. They truly enjoy the movement. She teaches them so many basic skills. And as a result of that, they are growing, they're making progress.
I just love what I do. It's my favorite thing. So it feels cool to get recognized, but it's my favorite thing to do day to day. I just really like the job.
Yeah! I really wish I wasn't dressed like a student.
It's okay. It's okay. So, Caitlin, we are here to let you know that you are the Secondary Horizon Award winner for Kansas City, Kansas Public Schools, and you will be representing us at the state level.
I nominate Miss Miller because starting school, teaching, is a challenge. Anyway, but starting in the middle of a school year, she started in January with kids who had been used to subs or coverage from other teachers. And she came in and took it like a champ.
I'm very hard on myself, like most teachers are. So like, it's just nice to know that what I do is noticed.
Both of the teachers that we recognized in the last 2 days were truly surprised. And when you read their letters of recommendation, you know that they are student-centered and they want to engage families and they want all of our students to graduate with a diploma plus, and they're doing everything in their power to ensure that.
We are back. We are back. We've got just over 2 minutes to go in this first half. We ask that you stay with us after the half. Right at the start of halftime, we'll have a brief commercial, and then we want you to come back and join us as I get have an opportunity to interview the superintendent, Dr. Anna Stubblefield. She'll be talking to us about the launch of this network, the KCKPS Sports Network, as well as giving us insight on the bond election. As you see, the Hawks are attempting to get it inbounds, deflected by the Sabres.
Harmon's going to need another ball handler up here to come help out because even Ali by himself, and Sumner's doing a good job denying the ball.
Gordon has done a great job of being in the mix as we see the Hawks getting the ball down court, and that was kind of an old-fashioned
shot. That was
shot.
An old-fashioned Dipsy Doo.
Yes, it is, by Angel Rivera.
I think he might have psyched him out. He was slow motion right there.
That was.
I wasn't quite sure if it was me again.
There you go. First personal foul committed by number 24, Jackson Davis. And the three-point play is complete by Rivera. 26-22 is the score in favor of the Sabres. Just under 2 minutes to go in this opening half. We're happy that each of you are joining us for this first game, as that basket is good by Huddleston.
That's a good one. Once again, they got inside that paint again, and the things happen when you get in there.
Just able to get it across the line.
This pressure is giving Harmon trouble, Doc.
It really is. Rivera
giving them trouble.
Rivera had a struggle holding on to that.
Yeah,
I think they called
him some changes at halftime.
I think they called a personal foul against James Rivera. That's going to be his third personal foul. So he's one of their key players. Let's see if Coach keeps him in for the remainder of the half. First free throw is no good by the Sabres. Looks like they're going to keep him in.
Yeah, Coach is going to take a chance and hold him in. He can't quite take him off court just yet.
Second free throw is good. Sabres have stretched the lead out to 7 now, 29-22. As we see pressure once again by the Sabres, but wing was just a little
I think they got
aggressive.
Vincent with that one, reaching in from the backside. And, yeah, you know, he was out of position, and he reached. Anytime you reach, you're going to get called every time.
That is Vincent's second personal foul. Shooting two free or shooting a free throw is Angel Rivera. And he will get a second one. Another placement. Wing is replaced with number 45, Reese. Second basket is good. 29-23 is the score. Gordon thought about it. Passed it back out to Davis. Davis gets it back to Gordon. Pretty far out there for a big man to be playing. Another basket is good.
That's big to little right there on the inside of the paint. Looks like coach has inverted the offense a little bit, put the big man outside, and it's kind of thrown Harmon off a bit.
Great basket by Huddleston. 31-23, 8-point advantage by the Sabres. See another rebound. I can tell you something here. Number 10, Chirombo, he really is doing an excellent job.
He is doing an excellent job. Coach Richardson is asking him to bring the ball up the court. He's asking him to play solid defense. He's also asking him to score. You see right there, he was aggressive. He knew. The shooter always knows if they're going to miss that shot.
At first, it was a personal foul committed by Jackson Davis. That's his second personal foul. Our first free throw is good by Chirombo. You see a substitution by number 21 for the Sabres, Adi, replacing Davis. Second free throw was good.
Good.
So now just a 6-point advantage. Another opportunity for the Sabres. See if they'll take it for the last shot. Gonna like the way they are distributing the ball and being very patient during this possession. Just under 10 seconds to go. Sabres are holding on to get the final shot. Ball is deflected. 3-point attempt is put up, and it's good at the buzzer! 3-point basket, goodbye. The one and only Jaden Gordon, and that is the end of the first half. 33-25 is the score. We'll be back after this commercial break. Stay tuned as you're watching KCKPS Sports Network. Stay tuned for Dr. Stubblefield. You see the replay of this shot. 3-point basket at the end, at the buzzer, and it counts. We'll be back after this commercial break.
The Latino Student Union strives to help Latino students here at Sumner feel that they have a community here with other Latinos.
Our main goal is to create a platform for students to share their experiences with their culture, cultivate their culture, you know, with different activities, and also bring to light any issues that could ultimately affect negatively our school environment overall.
We also help broaden people's ideas of Latino culture. So we do fundraisers such as selling traditional Latino snacks. And we partner with the HDF that helps give scholarships to Latino students around KC.
One of our biggest events of the year is our showcase, which showcases different Latino cultures. We do singing, dancing, sometimes poetry. Today's activity is a scavenger hunt. We wanted to just get people up and moving. You know, not every meeting is just work, work, work. We also want to have fun and build bonds with our members and have members, you know, get to, you know, just let loose and have fun.
To be in a group like this, it means a lot to me because I know many people from different generations have felt very not welcomed in schools. And I feel as this grows as a community, everyone starts to feel more diverse, and I feel very proud to be part of an organization like this.
We're here to announce that you are the elementary representative for the Horizon Award winner. So congratulations.
I wanted to nominate Hannah Brayfield because she exudes an exemplary teacher. Students in our building truly enjoy coming to music every day. They truly enjoy the movement. She teaches them so many basic skills. And as a result of that, they are growing or making progress.
I just love what I do. It's my favorite thing. So it feels cool to get recognized, but it's my favorite thing to do day to day. I just really like the job.
We're here to let you know that you are the Secondary Horizon Award winner for Kansas City, Kansas Public Schools, and you will be representing us at the state level.
I nominate Ms. Miller because starting school, teaching, is a challenge anyway. But starting in the middle of a school year, she started in January with kids who had been used to subs or coverage from other teachers. And she came in and took it like a champ.
I'm very hard on myself, like most teachers are. So like, it's just nice to know that what I do is noticed.
Both of the teachers that we recognized in the last 2 days were truly surprised. And when you read their letters of recommendation, you know that they are student-centered and they want to engage families and they want all of our students to graduate with a diploma plus, and they're doing everything in their power to ensure that.
Joining us is the Kansas City, Kansas Public School Superintendent, Dr. Anna Stubblefield. Thank you for taking a few minutes to chat with us.
No problem.
So we at MSTC Sports are excited to be partnering with the district on this new pilot program to highlight our student athletes. We'll be covering 6 boys and girls basketball games this year. Share with us your thoughts about the launch of the district's first sports network.
I'm pretty excited. I think when I took the position as superintendent, one of my goals was to always leave the district in a better place than I found it. I have no plans to leave, but every year we're just trying to implement things to engage our students and our families in our communities. And so we are just really trying to highlight our students across the board in athletics, activities, and definitely in the classroom.
Well, hey, you took that next question there. So in addition to highlighting your student athletes, students who are interested in broadcasting production, we'll get an opportunity to gain some real world experiences through the Diploma Plus program. Can you share more with us about the Diploma Plus?
So the Diploma Plus program started here in KCK about 2015. And our goal is by 2031, 100% of our students will graduate with a Diploma Plus. Last year, 61% of our students graduated with Diploma Plus. And that is that they're leaving with some sort of industry recognized credential, college hours, scoring a 21 or higher on the ACT, and real world life experiences and job experience. So client connected projects. So the students who participate in this will both have work experience and some other credentials that they'll be able to add and put on their resume and hopefully figure out if this is a role they want to go down after high school. They may learn like, it's not for me, but it's important for them to have all of those experiences.
That's really phenomenal. And I can honestly say I was there when we started it. Mm-hmm. And finally, on May 7th, the residents of KCK will have an opportunity to vote on a bond issue to build new schools, make renovations to existing schools. while we can't talk about everything in the bond, tell us a little bit about the enhancements that will support our student athletes.
So I will hit on a couple of different aspects. I'll start with, we're here tonight at J.C. Harmon. J.C. Harmon is one of the few 6A high schools in the state that only has one gymnasium. If the bond passes, they will get a second gymnasium. So with Slagle High School, that's another high school that only has one gymnasium. When we look at our middle schools, there are a couple that are just need to be rebuilt, and that would be Central and Argentine. And then we have about six elementaries that we would join together to bring them in the 21st century. But things that all of those will have a community impact, but specifically the bond would include building an aquatic center that will be available to the community. And also $20 million of the bond will go towards the main library to bring that project to life. Lots of other things. Every building in the district will get touched, and it will just bring a lot of added value to the community, create jobs for the community. And then we're, by doing that, we are investing in our students in Kansas City, Kansas Public Schools.
Well, Dr. Stubblefield, yeah. You have an amazing agenda ahead of you. I congratulate you on all that you've done. You know, I've told you, this district is special to me.
I know.
And all of us is special to us, and I'm so glad that you're here. Who would have thought us meeting at KU, students at the University of Kansas, both in the education program, and we are here to this time. Yeah. Well, hey, thank you so much for joining us. We're going to send it back to Chuck and his team. You're watching the KCKPS Sports Network.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, welcome back, everyone, to the halftime show of KCK Sports. Let's dive right in. Now, I'm going to talk to the, let's talk about the highlights from the first half. But before we get into that, let's hear from our panelists about their observations. And we're going to start with that last shot just before halftime. What did you guys see?
It's a playground. Driveway shot.
No, it's not.
It's a driveway shot.
No, it's not. You can't take away from my guy. My guy, look, he literally fumbled the whole shot. I mean, the ball. He fumbled the ball, grabbed it, turned around, and he had a clear, his flow was clear.
Well, I'm going to
agree. He followed through with everything.
It could be a driveway shot, but the young man has perfected that shot.
Oh, he made it.
And it was nothing but net. It didn't bounce in.
I said it's a driveway shot because she played in the driveway, so that's why she tried to. Oh, he perfected it because it's a driveway shot because he played with her. That's all I'm saying. But Janae Stuckey, you know what I'm saying?
At the end of the day, it was nothing but net, bottom of the nets. It was a beautiful, at the last second of the first half, it was a good shot.
Draw the shot up. He gets it 1 out of 10.
All I got to say is he didn't disappoint. I was waiting for a big play, and he hit it right at the last second.
That's awesome. Well,
that's second half motivation.
Somebody about to come out strong. Y'all don't understand. When you hit a big shot like that at the end of your first half, you're going into the locker room, pump, crump. You're already ready to be clutch when you come
now
out.
Now I can do a second thing for Harmon. What it can do for Harmon is it can turn around and say, hey, we were 6 points down until he hit, you know, the driveway shot.
Right.
So now let's focus up because we know we're in the game.
Yeah.
We young, you know, nobody expected us to be in the game.
Right.
And we in there.
That's
like,
true.
Second half, 0-0, let's win this second half.
Yeah.
Come on out here and play.
Yeah, that shot could definitely be a momentum changer for both teams. One team can just completely fold, the other team can just go on a complete
roll. Well, the former keeps watching the way he watched him shoot that shot. It won't be no comeback.
Let's move on. So they just want to talk about this drive.
I mean, he just stared at him in awe. He was as impressed as we was.
We'll see the second half. Well, Karen, during the pregame show, you emphasized certain keys for success. And how are both teams meeting those success?
Well, I talked about the time of possession and rebounding and communication. Right now, I see Sumner has 2 out of 3. They have time of possession, and they're communicating with the four-court press. You can't run a press without communicating. Harmon has rebounded.
Mm-hmm.
They're getting 2 and 3 attempts.
Mm-hmm.
They just need to come back the second half and start making some of those shots.
Yeah,
yeah, that's we've noticed that as Harmon is hitting the boards, and as you mentioned, 2 and 3 second chance shots, but those shots just aren't falling yet. And so if those shots start to fall, someone's got to do a better job on the boards. Mm-hmm. First of all, they can't allow Harmon to get those 2 and 3 shots. Can't allow them to do it. So we're going to go back to the game. We're going to go back and join Dr. J along with Coach Fennell. And that's our halftime show. So stay tuned for the second half. Enjoy. Hopefully we'll see some more miracle shots. did something for
it him. Was not a miracle.
You were driving shot.
It was beautiful.
He called it what he was supposed to call it. Here.
Check yourself.
Okay. Angels on the cool.
And welcome back to the start of the second half. We have the Sabres of Sumner Academy. They are leading the J.C. Harmon Hawks 34-25. Coach Larry, just before they get started, what are some of the tips? What do you have for the Sabres as they have the lead? What would you suggest that needs to happen?
So for the Sabres, they need to continue what they're doing, but they're going to have to cut off that paint and keep the Hawks out of that paint right now. And I'm sure Coach Al has went in there and talked to them about that. And for Coach Richardson, he's got to tell his guys he needs somebody else to handle the ball except for Ali.
There you
can't
go.
Leave him out there by himself. So we'll see what happens in this second half.
So you've answered both of my questions, and that's good.
I try, Doc. I try.
We see the quick turnover there by the Hawks, and Sabres get right back in business. They're rotating a three-point attempt by Wing just off, but that ball was caught by Contreras, able to bring down the rebound. Gordon has the ball, and seems to be doing a great job of handling the ball for the Sabres. We've got some nice rotation there.
It's like Coach Richardson come out in a 1-3-1. Huh?
Just off, up, rebounded, and stolen. That layup was good by Vincent Wing.
Vincent just happened to be in the right place at the right time, and he cut off the only guy that can get a pass, and here we see the same thing.
Gordon
gets in. Have to handle that ball a little better.
Huddleston's unable to get that put back. Quick rebound after the missed basket by Arrington Cody. Another steal, this time by the Hawks as they drive. Layup is off the mark.
Yeah, we see both teams come out now. They're just a little bit tight right now. So we'll see if they loosen up a little bit as it goes on as Vincent takes a shot from the corner.
Rombo would have liked to have that one back on this end. And that was a missed three-point attempt. Looked like a little slide.
That was the flyby. They called that the flyby.
Yeah,
Southwest Airlines is here. Wait for us. We did not know.
The basket was good by Sadiq. Boy, he slid his way to that one, but that's all right.
Hey, look here. That back foot was stopped. We saw it. It was stopped. We don't have the stripes on, Doc. We just have the mics.
It was a double-digit lead a moment ago, but it's back down to 9, 36-27. Here's the score. You see a ball, another three-point attempt. And
oh,
it is
there
good.
There it is. We'll see what happens right now. That's his second one. We're going to see what happens.
Good three-point basket by Sadiq. So 36-30 is the score. Just like that, it down by 11 just less than a minute ago. Now only down by 6. Hawks have a 5.50 run, but Gordon puts a stop to that with a nice high percentage basket.
Yeah, he just used the big body and just moved Ali out of the way and straight to the basket he went.
You got to credit that Saber defense. They are just badgering.
They are in all the spots.
Player control foul committed by Angel Rivera. That is his fourth personal foul. You got to think coach would want to look at taking him out.
Yeah, he's going to have to go sit down for a little while, and that's really going to hurt Coach Richardson's squad without him being out there on the glass. So we'll see what he can do with what his sub can do as he comes in here. Watch Whitmore pretty close.
Just under 3 minutes has elapsed here in the opening quarter of the second half. But it's a fast pace.
It is a fast pace, and there it is inside. We've been watching Coach Al's offense run that against that 1-3-1. You keep that ball moving baseline, and the guy dives down, and there it is.
Another basket by Huddleston. The timeout is called on the floor. So we have our student of the month for the month of January. Congratulations are in order for our January Students of the Month. We want to recognize the following students for being outstanding scholars. Bowie Lee at Bethel Early Childhood Center. Gustavo Human at Noble Princess Elementary School. Brandon Kinsey at Hazel Grove Elementary School, home of the Hornets, my school. Dim Lin at Arrowhead Middle School, and Andrea Fernandez at Alfred Fairfax Academy. We never knew it was called Alfred, did we?
We did not know that. That is new.
That we did. But let's give a big shout out to these awesome students, these amazing scholars that are doing it in the classroom.
Amazing.
Congratulations to each and every one of you, and congratulations to their parents.
Yes.
And to the community that supports these scholars.
That's right.
People, we want everyone that's watching to understand and to know that Kansas City, Kansas Public Schools has always had a great tradition. And Coach Fennell and I, we are products, and just about nearly all of us that are on the production committee, our team, we all are products of Kansas City, Kansas Public Schools. Very proud of our heritage here. We want to see it continue to improve. Score is 40-30 in favor of the Sabres as the ball is turned over.
Looks like Gordon went out to get a box of popcorn.
Yeah.
Oh, he's back. No popcorn.
Game number 13. Allen.
Some of our first substitutions in the second half. We're at the 4 minute 33 second mark. Another deflection by the Sabres and a steal. Basket underneath. Once again by Huddleston.
Yeah, the Sabres are turning the defense up, and they are attacking Harmon's ball handlers and jumping in those passing lanes.
So that basket is set was by Mendez.
Yeah, it's a little cheap one right there by Vincent. Just got caught out of position. If you're running side by side with the player, you're out of position. You must be in front of him, or they're going to call a foul every time.
Personal foul was committed by Wing. That's his third personal foul. First team foul of the second half. Three-point attempt. Just off the mark,
good rebound.
Rebounded and put back.
Good rebound.
That was a good basket by
Allen.
Allen G.
The announcer called him Allen G. I'm going to call him Allen G too.
10-point spread right now in favor of the Sabres. 42-32. Hawks, this time they do what the Sabres are doing and they steal it.
Yep.
3-point attempt. Just off the mark, but a nice rebound by the Hawks. Wow, he banged that one in. And that's a great basket by Ali Tarumbo.
Ali was not going to be denied on that one. He beat two Sabres to that ball and stepped in and at the line for a three-point opportunity.
That personal foul was committed by Andreas Huddleston. His first personal, or second personal, I'm sorry. Free throw is good. Completes the three-point play. Just like that, it's a seven-point differential in favor of the Sabres as they're leading 42-35. We see a travel there, just a few steps. By Contreras.
30-second timeout.
We want to congratulate our teacher of the month. Congratulate Miss Samantha Pounce of Lindbergh Elementary School.
I went there for 1 year.
Employee of the month.
1 year.
There we go. Hey, there you go. Used to always say Hazel Grove, the old building. We thought of it almost being the twin school.
That's right.
But hey, we want to congratulate Ms. Pounce for her great work and for what she does there in Lindbergh, for the scholars of Lindbergh and the staff. As you all know, the work cannot be done without dedicated and loyal professionals. So congratulations to you as employee of the month. 3 minutes and 23 seconds to go in the third quarter. It's a seven-point lead. This game, Coach Larry, has been a pretty interesting game here. You can't count the Hawks out.
The ebb and flow of this game, the only thing that hasn't happened is the Hawks take the lead, but the ebb and flow is keeping them in this game.
The three-point basket was missed by Jackson Williams. Another three-point basket there just off the mark by Contreras. Hawks are able to take control of it. A little bit too far, but he was able to throw that ball off of a Saber.
Good hustle. Good hustle.
Now I'm coming in for his favorite number 11.
That was a good hassle by both. And you just
we have several substitutions coming into the game. Another three-point attempt. The last one was off, and this one was just off the mark. He's got a really good shot, Coach.
It's a good shot. It's just not falling for him right now.
This hasn't fallen for Williams yet. Law of averages says it's going to happen sooner than later.
At some point, it will happen.
We saw Allen G unable to hold on to that, dribbling in traffic. Wing thought about the three-point attempt. Some want to call a travel, but that basket is good by number 50. Hawks bring it up the court, down by 9, 44-35 in favor of the Sabres. A little sliding there.
It's a little slick in that
corner
down
by Sadiq. The possession will go back to the Hawks. Jackson Davis is coming back into the game, as well as Contreras. Also reporting back into the game for the Hawks is Angel Rivera. Arrington Cody tries to get the ball in bounds along the baseline. Turnover committed by the Hawks. And they're going to call that foul before the shot. That's Jackson Davis.
Yeah, Allen thought someone was going to dive down there, Doc, and he got in trouble down up underneath the basket, had nowhere to go. Thought one of his teammates was going to dive, and it did not, and it was compounded by a foul on the other end.
The ball will remain with the Sabres as it was deflected off of a Hawk. We see Gordon going back into the game, replacing Angelo Reese. Gordon takes control of the ball and tries to inbound it, get it in to Wing. Wing thought about it. Got Contreras out at the top of the key. Gordon makes himself back to the top. They're going to call a personal foul under the basket.
Yeah, the ref just called it. Just kind of rolled him a little bit on the baseline.
By number 10. Second foul. For Lee Chirombo. Quick inbound play to number 50. Missed it the first time, but a putback.
Putback, yeah. You got to stay with it.
Oh, number 50 comes into action to try to deflect the ball. The ball comes to me, and what do you know? I get a chance to touch the
basketball,
Coach.
That's good hands. That's good hands right there. Boy, that was a real good pass by you as well. I really appreciate that.
That's right. I didn't want it to hit my suit, though.
No, you
got my reasons to believe pin right here. I don't want that tarnished.
We would not want to have any trouble.
Sabres have an 11-point advantage as we see the Hawks turn it over. Contreras is able to get in and intercept the play. Gordon takes it down court and is fouled. Basket no good. But there's a foul on the play. Gordon will be shooting two.
Yeah, the same thing we've seen plague the Hawks all game is ball handling. They only have one ball handler in the school. We can see that now as they turn the ball over quite a bit now.
It's a third personal foul committed by Muhammad Chirombo. First free throw is good for Gordon. Going into the game for the Hawks is Allen G replacing Rivera.
You know, Doc, right now we're going to hit you where it is. And right now the Hawks are like pancake flippers. They're just turning them over.
There you go. I thought the score should be 48. I thought those were two free throws. Ball was deflected by Contreras. 47-35 is the score. That ball was deflected, but will remain with the Hawks. It's Coach Larry, the Sabres have seemed to be able to figure out how to make further separation.
Yeah, they are applying a little pressure on the Hawks, and the Hawks are turning that ball over, and we know what happens when you turn it over. Oh,
some might argue that may have been a Euro step.
Well, the Euro step is part of the game. Even though we're in America, it works. We're going to the line for a free.
Jackson Davis's
third personal foul. That basket was good. Aaliyah Chirombo will be shooting the free throw to try to complete the traditional three-point play. And it is good. I wonder, when are we going to stop saying the traditional? We're going to say the initial? Don't worry about that, Coach Lee.
Yeah, yeah, we won't change anything. We won't be the ones to try to change it.
They're going to call double dribble. It was a cool play. Which
it looked good.
It looked good.
But it was, once again, illegal. It looked good, but it was illegal.
Illegal move there.
Dr. Naismith didn't write that in the book.
They're going to call that personal foul every time.
Yeah, anytime you reach in the paint and the guy going up for a layup and grab his arms, they're going to call that. Ali's going to the line for two shots now.
Call that personal foul on Marco Contreras. It's his third personal foul. Here, Coach Collins telling his team, Coach, take care of the ball.
Take care of the ball. That's one of the rules of the game. Take care of the ball. Put the orange peel in the basket.
That first basket is good by number 10, Aaliyah Chirombo. And he's cut the deficit to 11-7 now. 40-47. In favor of the Sabres. One-minute mark left in the third quarter. Deflection and a steal by the Hawks. They tip the driver, but number one was able to step in. Huddleston steal the ball, rebound. Number 10 for the Hawks. Sadiq takes control of it, gets it to Jackson. Jackson drives, but they're going to give him a travel. He took one too many steps.
Just a few.
Crash near the basket.
And it's possibly if they didn't call the travel, it would have been a charge.
Gordon's able to collect himself and take the ball out. Bounce pass in. Number 50 has it. I don't think this is his area to dribble too many times.
two dribbles and give it up. Not two dribbles give it up. Give it up.
That's it. At the end of this first quarter, we're going to go to courtside with Jalen Gordon. 15 seconds to go. Once again, it looks like the Sabres are going to try to hold it as they've done in the previous two quarters for the final shot. The last one, we saw Gordon hit a three at the buzzer. Just a second left. That was just off the mark. Well, stay with us. We have a commercial. Actually, we have a court chat with Jaden Gordon. You're watching KCKPS Sports Network.
How y'all doing? I'm Alan Watson. I'm here with senior guard Jaden Gordon from Sumner Academy, and this is Court Chat. Jaden, who do you pattern your game after?
I'm not the best shooter. I ain't the best shooter, but Giannis, it just quick moves straight to the basket, no flashy moves.
Gotcha.
Just straight to the Baja.
Absolutely. What's your signature move then?
My signature move is a change of the pace. Change of pace.
Right.
I showed up like I'm just trying to run a play, and then clean, blow by. They're not expecting it.
Gotcha.
I like that. I like that a lot. What's your pregame ritual? My pregame ritual, home games, I always got to get something to eat. I got to get something in my system, whether that's Subway, or that's some pizza, whether it's a sandwich from home, I got to get something in my system.
For sure.
So what gets you hyped before games then? And what gets me hyped, I'm a big Drake fan.
Gotcha.
So honestly, any Drake song, but my preferably Circle Loco by Drake.
I like that song a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and what's something your teammates don't know about you?
Something my teammates don't know about me is I take everything to the heart. I don't like losing. So any loss, whether that's in gym, whether that's pickup, whether that's in practice, I think about it and I go over what to not make that same mistake happen again.
I like that. Okay, that's Court Chat with Alan Watson and Jaden Gordon.
See y'all.
And welcome back. We are getting ready for the start of the fourth quarter. Sabres are leading by 7, 47-40 against the Harmon Hawks. Coach Larry, tell me what has to happen. If you're the Hawks, what do you need to do to come back, to beat this deficit, to come? I mean, they've had a deficit all throughout the game. They got it down to within, what, 3 or 4? They haven't been able to get over that hump. What needs to happen?
Stop turning the ball over. We know what happens when you turn the ball over. If you turn the ball over, the Sabres get an opportunity to score. When they score and you don't score, the lead will expand. So if the Hawks can stop turning the ball over and maybe force a few more turnovers on the Sabres, they might be able to get back in this game.
We did see the Hawks commit, force some turnovers. Yeah. The next thing is to make sure that they're able to execute.
They have to execute. If you turn them over, you have to be able to score.
Absolutely. They were able to get the lead down. They had a deficit, I think, as much as even 12.
Yeah.
Would have gotten it down to 7.
So, Doc, I know they talked a lot of it about this in the pregame, but here's where the shot clock comes into play.
Absolutely. So, starting out, nice rotation. Everyone's distributing the ball before the first shot, but only one attempt, and the Hawks are able to rebound, looking to cut this lead to possibly within 4, but that was a missed three-pointer by Sadiq.
He is clearly the three-point shooter, as we've seen him make a couple today. We've seen him miss a couple today.
Yeah.
But as a shooter, you must continue to shoot, especially if your coach gives you the green light.
Absolutely. Spoken well by Coach Sadiq, but almost was able to intercept that pass. The Hawks are able to get into their defensive set. Wing is surveying the court. Gordon has the ball, passing it on to Davis. Davis gets it back to Reese, and Reese gets it in. He goes in for the putback.
Oh, there it is, Doc. We've been seeing that play several times, and each time they go, that ball goes baseline, and it gets right in there.
That's great hands, Coach Larry. Wow.
Only thing saved that ball was the pee.
It's a turnover committed by the Hawks. You know, I tell the whole world, my mom said I was the prettiest baby, so you saved this face right here from destruction. I thank you. No more comments, Coach Larry.
I don't want no trouble.
It's a true fact. She's not here to refute it, so there we go. Nice steal and an attempt. A foul was committed by number 13, Gordon. Aleach Rombo will be shooting 2 free throws.
Yeah, that's one right there. That is. All Gordon had to do was not swipe at the ball.
Yes.
Anytime you swipe and come down, or they're going to call you for a foul every time.
He's going to make them earn it as a charity stripe, as they say.
They are free, but they charge.
That was the second foul committed by Gordon. And the second free throw is good. 41-49 is the score. We're in the fourth quarter, just at the 6.5-minute mark. So glad that you joined us for our inaugural game.
And there it is again. There's Gordon just diving in and great pass. Lay up.
I think Coach Collins has to be proud of that as we see the ball being deflected out of bounds and tipped by Sadiq. So that's going to be another turnover. But that was a great, great play by Gordon.
That was a great play. The ball went to the wing and he dove down and a great bounce pass. Well, that bounce pass is underrated.
It's underrated until it doesn't work.
Until it doesn't work.
Nice movement.
There we go. As we see, the ball moves faster than the players can move. And it's an easy basket on the other end. As once again, a turnover turns into more points for the Sabres.
Sweet basket by Huddleston. And that 7-point lead is now expanded to a 12-point lead by the Sabres. You see a 3-point attempt by Arrington Cody off the mark. Rebounded by Wings. They're going to say he traveled. Took a few steps.
They were short steps, but there were too many of them.
Yep, just too many.
Once again, illegal.
Here we go. Jackson. Fans, we are glad that you're watching us. We have more information to also share, and we will continue to share that at different times so that you know what's going on in the district. It's more than just athletics.
Yes.
It's going on here in the Kansas City, Kansas Public Schools, but this provides an opportunity for us to share with you what our students are doing and our staff and faculty and those who keep this great district going. It's done some great things there. KCKPS students win $10,000 grants. Hey, some very talented students from KCKPS recently won a $10,000 grant. Members of our KCKPS Quest, which is a group of students who belong to the Gifted Special Education Program in the district, took fifth place in the Burns and McDonald's Battles of the Brains competition. So congratulations to those students who were in that competition. Students competed to create an exhibit to be displayed at Science City inside Union Station. It's a great opportunity for our students.
Please start calling Ron. Please start calling Ron.
Basket was missed by the Sabres. It's a 10-point lead by the Sabres. The Hawks are looking to keep it going, but they turn the ball over. Actually, the ball is going to stay with the Hawks.
Stay with him this time. Last touch by Menendez.
Like to see that action. Yeah, that's right.
Please start calling your rides.
At this point, you want to see the Hawks execute, but unfortunately, Sadiq was trapped and unable to keep possession. Fast break, and that basket is good.
And once again, a turnover has the Sabres have been capitalizing on these turnovers the entire game. A great pass.
Huddleston and Contreras, that was a great matchup right there.
That was a great matchup. You go to that line for one. See if we can complete this trifecta here.
55-43 is the score. As we see, number three, Contreras tries to expand it, but just off the mark. Seems like every possession is contested early on by the Sabres. Good basket by Rivera.
You know, Rivera's just not getting back in the game. He's got those four fouls. The Hawks have been missing Rivera this game. He's been out for almost the entire third quarter and most of the fourth quarter with those four fouls.
Yes.
You see what happens when he comes back in. He contributes instantly.
He picked up his third foul with about a minute and 23 seconds left in the second quarter. That's kept him out. Can't run into the defender.
Well, you know, you must use the brakes or you're going to run through your garage door. It's closed. You cannot do that. Sometimes you just got to let you know the obvious, Doc. When the door is closed, you must hit the brakes and stop.
Absolutely.
And that's what we saw there.
Arrington Cody, that's his fourth personal foul. At this point, coach is going to keep him in. Gordon has been taking a kicking, but hey, he keeps on ticking. And that's a nice basket there.
That is tough right there. That is really, really
Angelo
tough.
Reese did an excellent job making sure that that counted. 11, he could probably teach my Jayhawks how to go up strong and finish. I won't bring that up.
Let's not make me angry today, Doc. It was a good day. The sun was out for a little while. It's not very cold.
I got you. Sunflower Showdown yesterday in Manhattan. Our beloved Jayhawks went down.
Somebody has to win, right? All right, we'll leave it at that.
Basket was good by Reese, that free throw to complete that three-point play. Another tip by Wing, getting the turnover. Ball was tipped by number 10, Chirombo, but he got a little bit of Gordon's body, so they're going to call that personal foul.
Yeah, anytime you reach and slap across like that, they're going to call it. Even if you don't touch it, Doc, they're going to make that call. So that's just part of the game. You must know that you cannot do that.
Absolutely. Referees have really called a really clean game, a solid game. A lot of times people criticize, but they've done an excellent job here.
It's been good. They're not messing the flow up.
And you know what? It's down by 13. The Hawks are still playing with some high intensity, as we see.
They're not giving up.
They're going to call that foul on the Wing. They're going to say it's on the floor. It's going to be his fourth personal foul.
Yeah, in that case, that was the only thing they could really do. He had to reach in there and try to grab the ball, and with that, he grabbed on.
That is his fourth personal foul.
Coach, late in the game, and Vincent now has four.
So we'll see if the Hawks can execute. Three-point attempt. You almost have to at this point, just off the mark. Arrington Cody. He connected earlier in the first half, but hasn't been able to make that connection since then. In fact, the Hawks, I don't think, have scored any three-point baskets in the third, in the second half.
Well, I think Ali had that one over here in the corner down here by us early in the third quarter. Not being very successful in that three-point shot.
3 minutes left in this ball game. The Sabres are leading 58-45. Gordon sizes up the court, gets it out to number 24. Davis unable to connect. Oh, that was a double dribble.
That was a double dribble. The anticipation to go inside, the defense flashed at him, and he just kind of threw him off a little bit. And once again, Doc.
Illegal? Alan G, he had the right thing in mind.
He had the right thing in mind. He made the right move. He just made an illegal move.
So the Sabres look to add on to this 13-point lead as we're sitting at just over 2.5 minutes remaining in this competition. Wing is taking the time. The ball was intercepted by the Hawks. Good defensive play by Muhammad Chiwambo. Almost thought he went over and back, but he wasn't quite.
Ball never went across.
Three-point basket attempt. Oh, just off the mark. Wow. Mekhi Whitmore, that was a great stroke.
It was a good shot.
Just did everything but go down, Coach.
It was a good look. It was an appropriate shot. Just didn't knock it down. So got to keep shooting it, though.
That's Arrington Cody's fifth personal foul. He is disqualified for the game.
Yes, he will have to go take a seat next to Coach. It's good hustle, though. One thing I will commend these Hawks for, they haven't given up.
Not at all.
They're still playing hard. It's nice. It's just not their night tonight.
And the Sabres were able to take advantage of the errors and continue to stretch out the lead.
Yeah, they applied the pressure early and found out who the ball handler was, and they adjusted to the only ball handler, and it's really caused the Hawks some trouble today.
The second free throw was good by Gordon. Been a great team effort. Yeah. As that basket is good by Sadiq.
I like that. He took it in. He had an opportunity to kick it out for the three-pointer, buddy. Took it into the chest of the big man. It's exactly where you teach it.
59-47 is the lead. Wink thought about the three-pointer. Pulled up. Missed basket. Ferris has the ball. Looking to make the next move. Defended well out there by Whitmore. Ball was tipped. They're gathered by the Sabres. Gordon holds on. Just at 1:15 left in this game. Sabres leading 59-47. Ball was deflected, but remains with the Sabres, and there's going to be a personal foul on the floor committed by the Hawks.
Yeah, they just got tangled up a little bit. A little hustle for the ball. It's just a loose ball foul. Two players going after it. And
that is his fourth.
The Hawk happened to be called for that as the Sabre fail.
Fourth personal foul committed by Rombo. That first free throw is no good by Huddleston. There's one more attempt. And it's good.
Good.
60-47 is the score. Just under a minute remaining in this competition. See, Sadiq, a three-point attempt. Wow. I mean, you can't get any closer than that.
You cannot get any closer to that. The orange hit all the orange and just didn't go down.
It just did not go down. Sadiq said, well, didn't.
Personal foul.
Personal foul. Ladies and gentlemen, you'll just realize Coach Larry and I, we have fun. Said, hey, I didn't get that three-pointer. I'm going to get something.
I'm going to get something out of it. I'm going to get my money's worth today.
Wing is at the basket. May is shooting two from the line. The first one is good. 14-point lead, 61-47. 40 and a half seconds remaining. We invite you to join us for our next broadcast. Another basket is good. Ball was deflected and stolen by the Sabres. Nice deflection by and steal by Contreras and a nice finish.
It's a nice back behind the back pass.
Yeah, that was.
It was missing. Hesitate a little bit and knock it down. Once again, it's a good shot.
The knees buckled, Coach.
They did buckle.
He couldn't help that.
The knees buckled and forced the ankles to buckle and created a what? Illegal play.
Ladies and gentlemen, we ask you to join us on Friday, February 9th, as the Sumner Academy Lady Sabres will take on the Lady Wildcats of Washington High School. 6 p.m. tip off.
Full timeout. Harvard.
Lindbergh Elementary and Schlegel High School have teamed up to launch a new reading program. The new program is called Book Buddies. A dozen of selected students from Schlegel will meet at Lindbergh twice a week to read to their younger counterparts. The objective of this partnership is to improve the literacy skills of the younger students and help upperclassmen become mentors to their younger peers. We wish both groups great success. KCKPS kindergarten student registration. We want to remind parents who have kindergarten students starting in school for the first time, kindergarten registration is now underway. To register, a student must be 5 years old and live within the school district boundary. The registration window closes on Wednesday, May 15th. To learn more, go to kckschools.org. KCKPS Early Childhood Programs. Parents, if you're interested in the early childhood programs at KCKPS, now is the time to make an appointment for applications. Programs include Head Start and State Pre-K. You can call 913-627-5257 to make an appointment. That's 913-627-5257 to enroll your scholars in the early childhood programs. Winding moments of this game. And that's the end of the game. The Sabres win this game 64-47 against the Hawks. Thank you so much for joining in. Stay tuned to the post-game show. We thank you on behalf of Coach Larry and myself. We send it back to Coach Chuck.
And welcome back for our post-game analysis. Folks, we saw a good game tonight.
Yes.
We saw two teams.
Great job, man.
Good job, man.
Final score 63.
Back in the saddle.
So good job,
Coach Matt.
Victory. What did you guys see tonight that was encouraging for both teams?
Well, one thing I'd say is that Harmon had fight, and that's what I wanted to see. I wanted to see they fight. They didn't lay down tonight. Mm-hmm. So that was really good. And then the other thing is that Sumner did what they're good at. Mm-hmm. And that's what a team has to do, especially at this time. It's only 3 weeks left in the season. Mm-hmm. So you got to be doing what you're good at. And Sumner did what they're good at. And then Harmon, they didn't give up.
And that's a good thing. You want to see some fight. You saw some fight. For a team that's now 1-11, mm-hmm. they could have rolled over and played dead, especially after that shot going into halftime. And they didn't.
You know, they could have gave up the first quarter when they were down 10-0, you know. Mm-hmm. But they fought back into the game. They kept the game close mm-hmm. for the most part. I think both teams did really good things. We back here discussing how Horman was doing really good with passing the ball. Absolutely. Coach Jamison mentioned mm-hmm. that. How they were doing really good on the rebounds. Actually, mm-hmm. I believe, I don't know about y'all, but I believe they actually did better on the rebounds this game. Yes. I just think their shots wasn't falling, you know, so they kind of came out underneath on that part.
Right. Well, I don't want to cut you off, but because I want mm-hmm. to get to the highlights
yeah.
For some of the games and stuff tonight, because there are some good things that happened for both teams.
Yes.
And you guys both were talking about them hitting the board, things like that. for Harmon to hit the boards and get more of their shots to fall. But they did show some good things as far as hitting the boards. Yes. And I want to wrote, you know, when we go to the highlights, you'll be able to see that in on Sumner and Harmon as they both were doing the same thing. So I think this was both said. They didn't quit. They didn't give up. They kept going and they fought hard.
I agree.
They just put the ball back in.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
And that happens with young teams, and that's one of the nemesis right now, mm-hmm. is missing layups. But they're aggressive. They were on the offensive rebounds. They had several attempts. Just didn't go their way.
And they did take some good shots. They took a lot of good shots, and they just wasn't falling. So.
And you have Sumner that didn't allow Harmon to get into their half-court offense, the full-court press. And we know with young players on a high school level, it is difficult.
Yes.
You know, when you're out there, and especially you don't have those ball handlers that see the forecourt. Mm-hmm. And so Sumner never allowed them to really get into that mm-hmm. half court, into the second half. And then I was able to see their offense. And what I admired about Harmon, they didn't panic.
That's true.
They still was able to get their ball across the half court. And, I mean, throughout the whole game.
Mm-hmm. And a lot of times they got it past half court, mm-hmm. and they got it to that open player because they had mm-hmm. two open players against one at mm-hmm. the bottom. But, again, the shot just wasn't falling. Because they got a good shot, but it just wasn't falling.
We also noticed, too, that somebody did press the entire game.
They did.
And there were times you see the press it broken down. That's a Collins staple. That's a Collins staple. And there were times when the press did break down, when Harmon did get behind them, mm-hmm. and took it in back, they didn't get behind them and for easy layup or they miss a shot or whatever. But there were times when the press did break down. And as you said, that's the first Collins staple.
Then they trap on the first pass. And so, like I said, even if you were playing college or professional basketball, it is difficult sometimes when you get into that press. You have to have that court awareness. And if your point guard doesn't have the ball, the best ball handler on the floor, 9 times out of 10, your wing players are not as good at passing the ball as seeing the whole court.
At the end of the day, the strength starts with first taking the ball out. Because you've got to be able to see if your guard's coming down here to the corner, you got to see those players about to trap that player. Don't throw it to that kid because their kid's going to get – that's like getting trapped by 3 people because you got the baseline, and then you got 4 people because you got the baseline and 2 people, you know. So the first taking the ball out has to be able to see that, do a ball fake, and then get it to somebody else. Like you get it right in the middle or to the other side. But
that's when I give kudos to Coach Collins because his role is also – so when you play that pressure, you got to also – push him into. We thought, you know, like just being a power rusher, we got to get him on into the gate. And they mm-hmm. pushed him into the gate, and they got him into making some uneasy passes mm-hmm. where they could track his steals, some long passes, and then end up with some.
Right, we're going to have some highlights here during the game as we watch some of the action that took place tonight with some of the. We'll be right back.
Callaway shot. That is a Jaden Gordon shot.
Why did I say he couldn't make it? I just said it was a race of his driver was fast.
I would say it definitely was a shot of the night. I think it just, yes, I think it just came from a lot of hard work and playing outside off the court. I got to figure out how to make it some kind of way.
Well, we can say it was a game changer.
It was definitely a game changer.
Although Herbert could have folded.
That's
they,
true.
You know, they could, that could have been a killer. It could have been bad before running the halftime. And the first, and somebody scored the first 5 to 7 points coming out of the half. And I'm thinking, this may have been a bad. Herbert kind of rebounded.
They came back.
They kind of came back.
They hit a run.
I think that's a testament to the culture of the Hawks.
Yes.
And I don't want to negate anything, because I think some is a real good team, but I also think Harmony. I think Coach Drew Richardson has, with the style, he has to push. And he's teaching the kids, educating, because you can see the difference from his first year to now on just how hard they play, plus as well as them being able to make certain plays.
Yeah, it's a matter of time before he puts his stamp on that program.
For sure.
You can see them, they're very young players, and you can see that some of the players were outpowering them. Mm-hmm.
Yes,
45 has excellent body control. He knows how to use his body. So you can see him getting down, and looks like a football player, too.
Yes.
They save the power as well. And you can see that Holman's kids are young, but I can see the coaching there. I saw the discipline there. Like I said, they didn't fold. In the fourth quarter, you can see them still trying to run their offense when they got the ball across the half court.
Well, I think that Herman, all the offensive rebounds they had, I think once they realize they settle down, and they put those shots back, if they don't make the shot, they'll be fouled.
Mm-hmm.
It'll be one or the other. And we had mentioned earlier during the game while we were watching it, that when they did make those rebounds, it was kind of like they were releasing the ball before they saw the basket.
They was.
Just getting rid of it.
They got the rebound and just started. It was the hand was already here before they even looked at the goal. Mm-hmm. So yeah, definitely. And that comes with being a young.
We go back with the inexperience, because we talk about muscle memory. Mm-hmm. So when I release the ball that close to the basket, you know, as a player, you don't think about it when you played a long time.
Because you know
you rely on your muscles. Mm-hmm. You know exactly what the spin to put on there. So they're still young, and so they're still trying to get the ball up and trying to score.
I got one positive that I think that both coaches should go into today. Obviously, you know, Sumner wins, so we can talk about it real and be positive, but they executed their game. They stuck with what they do well, and they did that, and it got them a win.
Yeah.
On the other side with Harmon, I think Coach Richardson can really push that this team actually did what they talked about in practice. They played hard. They played with pride. They
kept the fight.
They kept the fight. They went. And he's seen some improvement from his team as a team as they're moving into these last 3 weeks of the season. So I think it's positive really on both sides.
And as we mentioned, this is the third time these teams have played each other. And so it's difficult to beat a team 3 times in a row, but, you know, Coach Collins is able to pull it off. But I think each game, Harmon has gotten better in the process. They've learned from each individual game that they've had with Sumner. And Sumner's learned. They've learned they can't relax because Harmon will, will come after them.
And that the very first few minutes when they got that 10, you know, point lead in, you know, Harmon came right back up. We turned around, the score was, 13-16 or 13-10 or something like that? So, you know, they couldn't relax.
Harmon has some future shooters on that team, because I saw those guys take the shot from the baseline, and those were good shots. You can see them going up. You can see their form. They were just coming off the lip of the rim.
Barely.
And so they had teammates that could just put them back in there. But I saw, you know, they were balanced. And I saw good shooting. I didn't see them forcing it. And they were not shots like they were throwing it for luck. They looked like they knew what they were doing.
Good.
The form was there. So it's a young team. By this time next year, you're going to see those guys really getting up and down that floor.
I think Coach Collins brings up some of the self-inflicted wounds that we saw tonight. They can run with anybody in the state. I think they can. Because I've seen other teams play, some of the Sandy Mission schools and some of the Blue Valley schools. Some of them may not have the physical prowess of these teams, but if they can play that full court press off defense where they play the entire game, they will force
the physicality.
They can give somebody some problems.
They can give somebody some problems.
I think if they can keep that pressure for that 32 minutes, they really got it. You know, they don't have the inside presence. What they lack in inside presence, mm-hmm. they lack tenacity. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? They have that strength, they have the speed, mm-hmm. and they have that trap. Now, that's one thing he could teach us, how to trap and how to press.
Yeah, the trap.
And I think they're doing a great job. So I agree. I think they can play with anybody if they can keep it up for 32 minutes consistently.
Yeah.
And then also capitalize on the steals,
right.
making sure, you know, they can.
And they're able to keep it up for 32 minutes because if you watch their offense, they were rescuing offense when it was making those passes.
Yeah.
And so that's something you have to watch in basketball. Many times I mention a player like LeBron James. The reason why he's playing so long, you never see that person exert energy unless they're going down the score.
Right.
They're walking. So you have to, you know, the game is played from, it's a mental game. Mm-hmm. So you have to go with the X's and O's. So.
Well, that's going to wrap up tonight's analysis. You know, Sumner wins tonight 63. She slipped in LeBron, but yeah. Sumner wins tonight 63-47. We'll be back on Friday night when the Sumner girls will take on the Washington girls right here on the Kansas City, Kansas Public Schools Sports Network. And so thank you and our panelists for joining us. I appreciate it. We had a good time. Remember, all things KCK Sports, stay tuned and stay engaged. Thank you for watching KCK Sports, and we'll see you Friday night.
Friday night.
Friday night, everybody. Washington.